So I'm very pleased to have a very gender equality based panel. So we have Lee, Jane, and Chris. And what we are going to talk about now is what is going to save the world: reporting. So how many in here have been the author of a report? Okay. How many here have read a report the past year? How many have read 10 reports? 100 reports? Thank God, no. And we are talking, I mean, we are talking about reading the reports, right? Not just looking at them.
Not just skimming. Not looking at the GRI
just
index.
Just downloading them.
Okay. I'm impressed. Let me start by introducing not Chris, because he's already been introduced, but Jane and then Lee. So Jane Madden, and I hope I got that right, is the U.S. Managing Director, Corporate Responsibility at Burson Marsteller, and a prominent CR, Corporate Responsibility, I suppose, and Sustainability Practitioners with 25 years of experience. Jane has advised Fortune 500 companies across a variety of industries, extractives, transportation, technology, etc., etc. She's also advised in terms of ESG disclosure, and in this room, I suppose that everybody know ESG. Yes? Okay. It's actually one of my big things is that we need to figure out our language here, because other places out there, they will not necessarily know what we're talking about. You've been doing responsibility or sustainability reports for companies such as ExxonMobil, Xstrata, Bank of America, etc. So a lot of great experience. So you're in for a treat here. Then we have Lee. And Lee has, for Bloomberg, actually put together a report that where he both have GRI and SASB in one. I don't know, also integrated reporting in the same? No, integrated reporting not. How many in here do integrated reporting? None.
Not even pretending to do integrated reporting.
Anybody would like to do integrated reporting? Yes? One? No? Wow. I have to admit that I was behind the first integrated report in the world from Novozymes in Denmark. I've been working also in this field for many, many years, been with PwC, both in Denmark, where I'm originally from, and here in the US. I'm now based in Canada, in Toronto, and both have the pleasure of running the Global Compact, so the United Nations Global Compact network in Canada. So that is the world's largest network of responsible businesses, like 13,000 around the world, where the CEO have signed up and they're reporting on these issues. I also have a company called Be Accountability. Holding companies accountable, no. But what we want to talk about today is, as I said, reporting. And I don't know if we want to start, I mean, with you, Jane, in terms of when we had a telephone call and we were discussing all of these issues. So if we think about reporting driving value and being a good thing for the brand, but is it only the sustainability report that does that, or should this be embedded into what it is that the strategy?
Yeah, I think the short answer, it needs to be embedded in the strategy. And I think data is extremely important. It's the most important part of your report. But I think to your point, not only about language, is how do we communicate that data to multiple audiences and multiple stakeholders? I think we're beyond the phase where one report, one size fits all. And I'm hoping that this would make reporting less complicated, more simple, than adding on another framework or making more work for, teams internally that are often very small, who have to deal with an awful lot of data gathering and pulling that together. And then, until most recently, make a shiny, pretty report that often has puppies and kids on it, whether or not that's your core business. So I think that the trend that we're seeing is, number one, digital's leading the way. And I think we're going to see a transformation in the next 1 to 2 years. We will still have annual reports. I think we need to do that, especially for the stakeholders. And you need to have all this information in one place. It kind of makes it one-stop shopping for a variety of stakeholders. And you want to be able to look back at the year just as you do with your financial data. But I think we're going to see more digital leading the way, telling our stories year-round, and using that data year-round. And that's where digital is going to become a very big part of it. I'm hoping to see eventually that there still are many companies out there that if they do a report and if they follow GRI or IIRC and perhaps SASB in the next year or so, that there's still 100-page reports out there. And I know we're going to talk about the materiality, but is that all material? You know, and so I think what I'd like to see are more concise reports, really sharing the data and those messages that belong with that data that, to your original question, show the value that sustainability, corporate responsibility, ESG, whatever you want to call it, is bringing value to the company. And also that you're talking in language that resonates, whether it's to a consumer group, and that's going to be very different the way you talk about it, and basically the level, the way you talk about the data and what level. I think in general, this is very generalized, but consumers want to know, are you doing the right thing? You know, they just want to feel secure that your corporation is doing the right thing, whether it's environmental or social issues. They feel good. They feel less guilty about buying your product. Whereas we heard yesterday, investors are looking for very specific data. They do care about your scope 3, mm-hmm. now maybe your scope 4 emissions. And what does that mean? But a consumer is like, I don't even know what scope 1 is. Why should I care? Mm-hmm. Like they're looking for the Uber, the umbrella message, where there are, you know, NGOs and investors are looking for different data. And don't forget about the G in ESG. I think a lot of people forget about governance. And particularly if you're a consumer-facing company, you know, your consumers, unless you're you know, Enron, you know, people don't really think about corporate governance until it goes wrong, where there are NGOs, shareholders, other stakeholders, investors are concerned about how you run your company on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, and actually building on that, and Lee, when I said that you put together this report that both have GRI and SASB, and when we also talked, I said, so does this drive value? Is this something that actually you can see that this is giving you something both internally and externally? And with your company, is this something that the board, is there anybody actually looking at this internally? And what value does that bring?
Yeah, so our report is all about communicating both internally and externally the business case for sustainability. That's what we are charged with driving throughout the firm and that's also incorporating it into our day-to-day strategy, as you talked about before. So there's three key messages that we throw out there. One is the money that we've saved through sustainability, which year-to-date over the last 7 years is $81 million, which is also tied to carbon and efficiencies and just better operating practices, right? So our goal is to decouple environmental growth from financial costs, right? So that's what we do. Second is the new products that we're bringing to market, right? That help our customers thrive in a low carbon economy, whether that be ESG data on the terminal, Bloomberg New Energy Finance, Bloomberg Media, bringing these issues to the forefront of our customers. Thought process in their day-to-day business practices, right? So the power of Bloomberg Media to amplify these stories, your stories, right? We report on the stories in this room. And then third, the programs and services available to our employees that enable us to attract and retain top talent. Those are the three biggest stories that we have. Now, we don't put out a 100-page report every year. We do it every other year. So we have taken the approach that the narrative really doesn't change much year to year. And I think that's an important message that we communicate upwards, right? So our reports go through a series of sign-offs all the way to the top of the company. And that's an important opportunity that we get every year to reinforce those three things that I talked about before. We do a full GRI index, we do a SASB update, but the difference between a full report and an update year is probably in the neighborhood of 60 pages of narrative. We fill it with a lot more graphs. You won't see people holding hands and puppies in our reports. Ours is very data focused, go figure, right? And very business focused. So you'll see a lot of graphs about uptake in clean energy or ESG data usage by our customers. You'll see a lot of graphs around data center efficiency and carbon reductions. You'll see around volunteer efforts. All of the graphs in our reports, updates are year to year, really just supplement the narrative, which is large or small depending upon what year it might be. Luckily, this year was an update year. It's much easier.
And do Bloomberg himself care?
Yeah, absolutely.
Does he see it?
I can show you. two days ago, a week ago, because we released our report yesterday, we got the sign off from him. He reads them, he looks at them, he comments on them, much more than I would have ever anticipated.
And what about the rest of the employees?
Well, we released our report with a message from Mike, which always helps with employees reading it, on Tuesday. And it went out at 5 o'clock, and we've already had 6,600 employees open the message and read and click the report. So I don't know if they're reading it cover to cover. I don't think anybody reads these reports cover to cover. But if they read Mike's letter, if they skim what we're providing, the areas that's most important to them, either the products we're providing, the stuff we're doing for the planet, or the services that we provide our employees, that they can get involved and volunteer in their local communities. That's all I can ask for. If each of those 6,600 employees came back with one nugget, I'd be happy.
I think Lee makes a really important point that we often miss the opportunity for stakeholder engagement using the reports. So they're doing a great job with employees, but I think you can also use the report, whether it's that it's day and time, the day you launch it, but using that data as ways to reach out and message to different stakeholders, both internally and externally.
Yeah, and you can say in that sense, Lee, does it make your job, I guess I'm answering my own question, if it makes your job easier, that employees are kind of like interested?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of the first things that I was tasked with was to influence behavioral change at home and at work. And so this is just one more opportunity that I get every year to make them A, proud of the company that they work for, B, proud of the work that the company is doing, and C, to get them involved one way or another, whether it's as simple as composting their trash or going out and planting trees or raising their hand and saying that, they want to learn more about our products so that they can put it in front of, their customers.
Chris, just started a new company. That's not completely true because it's actually splitting two companies. If you think about, a report that you have had a report for many years and suddenly you're splitting it in two. Is there anything you start thinking, could we do this in a different way when we now can start over?
Well, one thing I would say, Hella, is that HP was a leading practitioner of the sustainability report as phone book approach. When I joined the company 5 years ago, the report was over 200 pages. So I don't know if anybody's got a report longer than that, but we were able to whittle that down to 140 as the joint company. And part of that was because HP was a very complex business. I mean, think about what I was discussing in terms of data centers and services and software, which is now in the HPE company. Well, on top of that, we had a report on PCs and printers and many of the issues there in terms of recycling, conflict minerals, et cetera. So it was a very complex business to report. But I think, and it also helped drive a lot of strategy. So in the presentation I gave earlier, you heard me refer a number of times to footprint and scopes 1, 2, and 3. And, those kinds of innovations, the inclusion of those data in the report over the last few years has been extremely important in shaping our strategy and actually getting going on a number of initiatives that have actually had significant impact. So when we first reported our full carbon footprint and then the following year our full water footprint, that enabled us to start looking at, well, how do we set goals? Not only against operations, which for us is only 5% of our carbon. Those are the buildings and the travel and all that sort of stuff that we do as a company. 95% of the footprint was either in the supply chain or in the use of our products. So, having that insight then enabled us to set goals against those things. So I don't want to denigrate the phone book approach too much. But yes, absolutely. Now, as a new company, we have a tremendous opportunity to really kind of recast things. One of the things we want to do is we want to put the data in a place where it can be accessed and understood and it's simple to get to. We call it the data PDF. It's not something we're going to print, but it's very consumable and very easy. We think that it's going to be helpful not only with our customers, but also, in terms of stakeholders externally, like we call them the sustainerati, right? So the folks who like to report on what we're doing. But then, to Jane's point, making the actual news and the stories about what we're doing in sustainability much more interactive and use the power of the internet to help us to do that. So those three themes that I referred to in my presentation, efficiency, fairness, and opportunity, will be featured on the HPE.com website and stories about what we're doing and also not just stories, but also achievements, right? So footprint and data and goals that help people to realize, the impacts that this company is having and which will also enable us to update the news on a more regular basis. So I think, for me, it's an evolution. I think, the phone book had to go and we had to move to something, to Jane's point, that people can really interact with.
So if you think back on when 1947, where you were talking about the betterment of our society, at that point, if that thought leader, you could put it like that, has said, what is important to report about what we are doing? Would there be anything where you say, hey, he would have said, we need to report about this and this and this, or do you think that it's a totally different world that we are living in now where, yes, as you said, we all have these reports? I mean, at that point, you had a financial report. That was it. And it basically did not communicate that much.
Yeah, I mean, I think certainly the world has changed, from 1947 in terms of kind of what people are expecting. I think the world is expecting transparency. They're expecting us to be very clear about where our impacts are, what's material to us, and what are we doing about it. So I think those are the key things that the report needs to get across. And, whatever framework works for you, whether it's GRI or SASB or IIRC or whatever, it's almost not that important as long as you're telling that story and engaging the right audiences, whether it's the sustainerati or it's employees. I totally agree with Lee. I mean, it's a motivational and attraction, of talent kind of an opportunity. But for us, most important are our customers and, giving them the confidence that, we're doing things the right way so that they can, have us as a trusted partner.
And Jane, we were talking at some point in terms of the board of directors. Mm-hmm. And where I find from time to time, when I talk to the board of directors, well, they might have received the report and have said, yes, we're reading it and we are signing off on it, but how much they really been involved in figuring out what is it that's material or important to communicate.
In my experience, I think that boards have very little interaction with the report until it does. They still often get the few printed copies, and you know they'll get it at the annual meeting. I mean, we even see this with the timing of a lot of reports. You know, in our world, we're at the end of reporting season, so we're about to launch, you know, reports, and I think many of you either have just launched yours. But now through the end of June, when it's annual meeting season, that's when the board's looking at this. And I think we're missing an opportunity to engage the board early on when you're doing your materiality analysis. You don't have to engage the entire board, but maybe committee chairs, and particularly those that are responsible for ESG issues. And even if you're not doing a materiality analysis every year, I think it's a missed opportunity. They have responsibility, ultimately, for the performance of this company. And whether it's, I believe, as Evan said yesterday, you know, we really shouldn't be distinguishing between non-financial and financial data. ESG data and financial data are all important in terms of your corporate performance. And I think we need to keep that in mind. And I think boards in general have been less engaged. There are certainly exceptions, but I think that might be another frontier in terms of, you know, we've gotten to the C-suite, we've made the business case, we now have to get, for the most part, we're in a much better place than we were even 5 years ago. I think that's the next frontier in terms of governance.
Can I ask how many in here involves their board of directors? And in the report, in terms of figuring out what should the report actually be talking about? Sorry, can I ask again? How many in here involve the board of directors before they start figuring out what they should write in the report? Do I see one hand? Yes, I see one hand. And how many get their boards to sign off after? And how much can be changed at that time where they can actually sign off? Little tiny bit? Okay. Okay, so what we're actually saying is that the board of directors, yes, they get this to sign off on. But if they normally, they will then read it and say, it sounds all good. But do they actually ask any critical questions? Do they actually read it? I guess that's the question. So how many involves the CEO? Okay, more. Okay. Well, front end. Let's take the front end first. How many involved the CEO before we start the process? Okay, fewer hands. And
can I just jump?
So yes, please.
I think, you know, you can't go back to your board every year, right, and say, this is going to be my plan, right? They're busy, and they're probably going to get annoyed by that approach.
I would disagree.
Me too. Sorry.
Okay.
But sorry, I didn't mean to
agree to disagree. You know, I think what we have done over the last 7 years of doing this is co-develop a framework in which we report that makes sense for Bloomberg. Now, when there are shifts in how we report, right? So last year we decided to report against SASB. We didn't make that decision in a bubble, right? That was a very collaborative effort. Amongst the chairman's office, legal, risk, the business lines, and us to decide, is this the right move for us? But with respect to the meat and potatoes of every report every year, you know, I just don't think that's a good use of your face time with the board. Mm-hmm. Now, when we decided to do a full report 1 year and an update in between years. Again, that was a big decision for us because it's a little bit different than the typical approach, right? That was a collaborative decision. When we decide to, post our 2020 goals, that's a collaborative decision. So I mean, the point of this, you know, is to say that I think you need to choose your points. You have to, you know, say, what am I doing this year that's different than last year? Is there the potential for controversy? Am I better off going after that controversy on the front end? Or is it not that big a deal that I'll highlight to them in my memo when I send them the report for sign-off? And of course, if the board wants to change something, and it's happened to us where we almost had to reflow the entire report, I'm not releasing anything unless I get that sign-off. So, you know, I just think, you know, it's important to get their buy-in. We report to the chairman, so maybe it's a little bit easier for us to have those conversations and they don't seem so, you know, big. But if you go to them every year with your plan, you're going to, you know, I think you're just going to wear thin.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point. And I wasn't talking about the actual process and whether or not you should, you know, do an integrated report or which indicators you should be reporting out on. But I do think there needs to be a conversation about performance, the way that you talk about financial performance, and whether that's in a quarterly basis at the meetings or via committees, there needs to be more engagement. And again, maybe Bloomberg is exceptional and an exception.
Yeah, and
can't argue with that.
I know. I knew you wouldn't.
and I have a past as a financial auditor, so I've been very much involved in also the financial reports. And I think the way where we have the CFO, etc., it's a much more integrated approach. And I would love for these issues to have this almost the same process in that regard, so that it also gets more attention. Chris, if you have,
on the spectrum, I think, you know, Lee raises a number of great points, and I agree. I think it's important to engage senior management, whether that's the CEO or their executive committee or the board, when you're making fundamental changes in the report or in the strategy, right? So, you know, those are definitely key touch points that need to be taken into account. In terms of HPE, I think, you know, we have a very, maybe it's a Silicon Valley thing, we have a very decentralized approach. And we are empowered to get things done, which is also great. So, I mean, that need to go back and touch base on a regular basis is kind of not that relevant. And we kind of just get on with it, which I think is because we have people throughout the value chain, because we've created that kind of a culture, that it doesn't have the need for central control to the same level. But I think every company is a little bit different. So, you know, I think you need to adapt to your internal audience as well as the external one.
Absolutely. I mean, we're a private company, right? So there's certain things that we're not going to talk about, right? But there's certain things that we have to talk about, right? Because we want to attract the best talent. We want to show to our customers that we're, you know, giving them an edge in their investment decision-making process. So, you know, we have to balance that private versus public, still being transparent, still, you know, putting out a report. It's a fine line between, you know, what we feel comfortable disclosing versus what we don't. And, you know, as a private company, we have that latitude.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that's a good point. And if you think about materiality, in that sense, and you think about what it is that is in the sustainability report versus the financial report versus the 10K. And I don't know, would you say that should start being almost the same, or the things that's been talked about, or would you say that it is should be totally different what's in the sustainability report from the financial report? I'm not really sure who of you I'm asking.
Yeah, I mean, we don't put out financial reports. I could say from our customer's perspective and from, you know, the data gathering that we put on the terminal, you know, we would love to see, you know, either integrated reports or reports that come out at the same time. So mm-hmm. they don't necessarily have to be the same one. But, you know, having financial reports that come out, you know, that have, you know, let's just say fiscal year end versus sustainability reports that come out, you know, calendar end. You know, for the investment community, that's very confusing, right? Mm-hmm. Because they then have to, level the playing field and try and figure out, well, you know, they're you know, when we're baselining and we're doing comps, you know, How do we you know, get the ratios right, you know, to say GHG versus sales when they're different timelines and, you know, all that stuff. So, you know, we'd like to see them come out at the same time, whether they're integrated or not. That would be, we think, a beneficial move.
And the same story?
You know, I think the story, as I think Chris is leaning towards by separating them, the story's supplemental. I think the story caters to a different set of stakeholders, maybe more the people side. So, you know, potential or current employees. You know, I think the data, the numbers is what's really going to move the markets, just like the 10K does. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think this story, I don't want to say it's less important, but it's not as important to our customers.
I'd love to move our data closer to the financial in terms of timing. We report sustainability and financials on a fiscal year basis, so at least they are comparable. The issue we have is twofold. One is that sustainability data doesn't tend to come through to us as rapidly as financial data, right? And this is part of our, I don't know, junior partner role in companies, right? It is because the financial, obviously, reporting is essential, especially as a public company. So that's one issue. The other issue is we also assure many of our key performance indicators in sustainability. So we work closely with corporate auditors, Ernst & Young, and they assure our carbon footprint, our water footprint, and some of our other key data that go into the report. And so that also is a process that we think adds a lot of value.
Absolutely.
Because then when I get up and say things like, you know, only 5% of our footprint is in operations, I have the assurance behind that that we've collected those data correctly. So,
yeah. If I could add, from my point of view, in an ideal world for public companies, it would be the 10K. Mm-hmm. But being very practical, I think that is a big challenge right now for corporations in terms of time, in terms of what the other business priorities are, and whether or not we ever get to SASB's goal of having at least some ESG indicators in the 10K. I think we'll get there. I don't think we'll get as many as SASB mm-hmm. wants. And it still might be voluntary, though. So it might become more of a, this is a best practice versus you have to do it.
Yeah.
You know, SEC has an awful lot on its plate right now. It's challenged with even enforcing Dodd-Frank on conflict minerals and other reporting. And I don't see integrated reporting. Again, I think we'll have best in class and variety of what people are calling integrated reports. But we're not going to see it legislated in the U.S. anytime soon.
I have a slide that I will try to show, and I have to say that I have not shown you this because it
we'll
came
verify.
In 5 minutes. So I'll see if I can make this happen. Otherwise, I need to have help from Will.
Chris, you're new tech, right?
Yes.
You
that's what they say.
And I'm not sure if you can see this at all. And full transparency, I'm the chairman woman of a company called eRevalue, and I asked them to put this together, like, middle of the night because they're in London. So, and what I asked them to do was to say, if we look at the U.S. and what are the issues, and what they do is they scan through all the big companies' reports, and then they say, what is it that these companies are talking about? And so if we look at the sustainability reports versus, and I'm said annual reports and then SEC filings, what are the issues that companies are talking about? And what's interesting when we start, what you said before in terms of employees, etc. And I don't know if you can read it because I can't. Can you guys read this?
Can you just go through the list?
I can try. So I have it here in another form. So the one that says sustainability reports. So it says that the top has greenhouse gas. Okay, thank you. Can you read it now?
Yes.
Okay. So this is then the sustainability report. So greenhouse gas, recycling and waste reduction, employee development, energy reduction efficiency, I assume, energy use, occupational health and safety, responsible business, water use and efficiency, non-hazardous waste, and philanthropy. So this is the sustainability reports. Greenhouse gas, there's a lot about that end. If we then go to the one that's talking about the financial reports, I don't know if that is the next one. Yeah. So here what companies are talking about, the same companies, and this is only U.S. companies, in the financial report, shareholder activism, employee benefits, climate change, responsible business, executive compensation, consumer rights, board compositions to your governance, information security, customer satisfaction, investor relations. And I have to say, these are more the ESG areas, what they're talking about. And then the last one, if we go to the SEC, because I actually thought this was the really interesting point. Apparently, number one is employee benefits, customer satisfaction, consumer rights, climate change, responsible businesses, harmful substances, etc. So it's not that it's, and I have to take it on face value in terms of these companies that's involved in this. It's not that we are not talking about these issues in the 10K. The question is, if I go back before I asked you how many have actually ever read a sustainability report, and many of you, of course, said yes. How many in here have read a 10K? Good. Okay. All right. Well, maybe my point is not that. but I wonder, you know, Lee, if you think about these issues, and you have not had a chance to prepare at all this, but you're not a public company. But when you said before, well, there's something that we are not talking about in there. Do you think that the companies out there, the CFOs and the sustainability people, are talking together in terms of these issues and the investor relation?
Yeah, I think in the leading companies, they definitely are. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, whether it, you know, we have constant conversations with the CFO office around, you know, capital expenditures on renewable projects that we want to do, or you know, PPA outlays that we want to do, and the, you know, how we're reducing the company's energy bill. So, you know, I think it's important, you know, that you have a dialogue across the firm on an ongoing basis, you know, not just when you're doing your report. You know, I think, you know, we've touched on SASB, but we've reported against SASB, and I'm looking at these buckets, and I got to say, you know, where the SEC is saying climate change, and you know, the one before that called it something else, and then in the sustainability report we're calling it greenhouse gases. I mean, there's a language problem in this world for sure, but like, these aren't so far afield that like we can't you know, bring them together and report in a common way across the different reporting agencies within our own firms, right? You know, the goal of SASB is to bring decision useful, comparable, industry specific material issues to the investment community, right? And depending upon how you define materiality, you know, a lot of these buckets that I'm seeing in here, right, are very close to the buckets that the specific metrics that we reported for SASB. So it's just kind of, you know, shifting a little bit that when you're talking about, you know, employee benefits, is that, you know, your true benefits, but it also probably involves, you know, employee engagement, right? And employee satisfaction. Well, those were two metrics that we reported against for SASB. When you're talking about climate change, well, they asked us for, you know, impact of our data centers and GHG. I mean, workforce changes, they ask us for turnover. You know, that happens to be one of the things that we don't report as a private company. But my point is, they're not so far afield that they can't be reconciled at the point of reporting. And I think, you know, the practitioners, us in the room, are like, we're already doing GRI. It's a big lift. It's an important lift because it kind of is the best way to get started on this journey, right? You're looking at everything. And now we're thinking like, oh my God, now we're going to have to layer on SASB. I'm telling you right now, SASB is not that different from what you're already reporting on GRI and what you're already reporting in your SEC filing. It's not that hard. It's not that scary, and it's not a lot more work. It's actually going to help you be a little bit more laser focused.
Yeah, I think you make a couple of really important points, Lee. I think industry specific and material are two really important points. And certainly, this list I know is generic because, you know, it's kind of obviously a mix of companies. But, some of these issues are highly relevant to a company like HPE, and some of them are less relevant. But I think what's happening is that with sustainability and financial reporting, we're reporting on them from different perspectives. So you take something like climate change. You know, from my perspective, I'm reporting on what is HPE doing about climate change? What are our steps? How do we quantify it? What actions are we putting in place to reduce our footprint? My friends in finance are probably reporting on this from the point of view of risk.
Yep.
You know, what's the issue that is going to affect the company of HPE materially from a financial risk point of view with climate change? You know, is that going to cause disruption in our supply chain? Is it going to, you know, cause issues for our customers? Are there going to be things that we need to put in place to mitigate that risk, not only to us physically, but to our customers as well? So does that mean that conversation could be better synced? Yes, absolutely. I think the fact that we're having the same conversation with different audiences in different ways probably is not highly efficient.
No, but we are getting closer and closer.
But we are, I would definitely getting closer to, because I think, you know, because of materiality, mm-hmm. I mean, the fact that we go through a materiality exercise and many of those issues have crossover into areas of risk, financial risk.
I want to make sure, yes, that we actually get questions from you all. We have... Yeah, and actually Exxon had a question
I can't speak to what's going on in the U.S., but I know that there's another initiative of which Mike Bloomberg is involved that's being pushed by the Financial Stability Board. It's called the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, and that is to bring another framework, right, for instituting climate change risks and opportunities into G20 country financial reporting. So that number will go up in the U.S., but it will also, you know, be more reflective in countries like Canada. Yeah. And so this is to, you know, alert the financial community about, you know, what should we be concerned about, but both from risk and an opportunity, because we see this as an opportunity. You know, it's an opportunity to save money. It's an opportunity to open new markets. Mm-hmm. It's an opportunity to provide new products and services. It's an opportunity to engage your employees and attract the new opportunity. You know, so, you know, we're having a little language conversation over there, you know, corporate social responsibility. You know, I hate that term. You know, we call it corporate social opportunity, right? It is an opportunity to do well by doing good.
Guidance,
yeah.
Yeah, guidance. I think Exxon had was asked to why they did not report in that way. So yes, there's a difference from us, Francisco, in Canada, but it'll come. Questions?
I'm always interested in the nuts and bolts of sustainability, corporate responsibility report development, and I'm wondering if you can tell me your content development teams, because you've got text, you've got, if you're doing online reports, you probably have video snippets, photography, infographics. How do you manage all that? Who puts it all together? What do you review? Do you review just a test website, or do you have a content document that you circulate? If anybody can comment on any or all of those questions.
Geez, I wish I knew. No, it really is a big team effort. You know, like I mentioned, we have Ernst & Young, who's assuring our data. We have folks internally who are collecting those data and putting them into reportable forms, which is one of the reasons why it takes us a little longer than our colleagues in finance. We have a writing agency that does the writing for us and connects into what we call subject matter experts, or in true HP fashion, SMEs, right? Everything is an acronym at HPE, including the company name. So I mean, it's a real team effort. It requires a lot of coordination. We use all sorts of tools to help us do that. I think we're on Office 365 now to make it even more seamless than it was before. But I mean, it is a rather time-consuming project, actually, and we sometimes liken it to painting the Golden Gate Bridge, because as soon as we finish, we have to start again.
Yeah, I finished mine Tuesday. It went out. I'll probably start my next one June 1st, July 1st at the latest. It's a big lift. And I think that's part of the reason why, because it is such a collaborative effort across the enterprise, that you want to give all your colleagues, you know, a little shout out mm-hmm. in the work that they're doing, mm-hmm. you know, because you know, they help you, right? The coalition of the willing, you know, we're all, you know, master, you know, conveners, right? Mm-hmm. Like how do, you know, you're constantly selling the benefits of sustainability internally and trying to get them, you know, to help, you know, get us where we want to go. And I think that's part of the reason why sometimes these reports become unwieldy, because you're just really concerned about making sure that all your internal stakeholders receive the rightful credit. You know, we like to say we don't really do anything. We just really, you know, benefit from the hard work of our employees. And so it's kind of hard to say that, well, we talked about that last year and, you know, we've done some good stuff again, but it's maybe not as important as something else. And so we cut it out. And then you just, you know, it's you're really making some tough decisions to get it to 140 pages.
Yeah. Now, just to build on, that's a really good point. I mean, when we took over the report writing about 4 years ago, my boss said to me, "Are you sure you want to do this?" Because it was just that kind of a heavy lift. But I think what was kind of cool about it was this convening role and bringing people together is really powerful, right? So getting that coalition of the willing working together, the SMEs talking to each other, really important. And then the other great thing about reporting is there is a deadline to it, which kind of galvanizes people, right? Mm-hmm. We've got to get this thing out the door by, we pick a date and we commit to it, right? So that kind of drives a lot of activity that might not happen if we didn't have a report to produce.
But to specifically answer your question, I write the report at Bloomberg. I have a lot of help getting the data. We have someone on our team who specifically is our analyst. We have a design agency who helps us put it together on the web and in print. But for the most part, it's an internal narrative building.
It's an Italian company that actually just put it out there so all their stakeholders can just actually help them write the report and comment on different things. It's in Italian. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I don't understand it fully. But it actually, so they you know, put something out there and then they ask their stakeholders to actually help them write it. So it's a, you know, it's all year round. It's just a living document.
I can't imagine anything more scary.
What about you, Chris?
It's a wiki report. It's a wiki report. I'm with Lee. I definitely want to control the message. Definitely.
All right.
Hi. I just have a quick question about the health benefits being high up on the list there. Do you think it was influential because of the healthcare reform and all the reporting that had to be done to the government? I could almost that now it's starting to be married with CSR.
I have to admit, I think you're right. But I have not in terms of, so what they basically do is that they scan through, in this case, all of the listed reports and see, okay, what is it that's been talked about? So, but that seems as a good thing. I could compare this to what are they talking about in Europe? What are they talking about other places? And I'm quite sure you're probably right. It would be right. Different on the list.
It'd be interesting just to see 3 years ago because they only started asking for health benefit reporting this year.
Right.
So it'd be interesting just to see the difference 3 years ago to today, to see the government influence on that.
Yeah. I can ask them.
I'm going to ask maybe a radical question. So if we are moving content
Can I just ask you to say who you are and where you come from?
Oh, sure. I'm Samantha Mazurbi. I'm from Scotiabank, CSR, and I do all the reporting. So my question is actually about the purpose of reporting. So if we are moving to storytelling on our websites, and we're all doing things like CDP and DJSI, and we're engaging with Sustainalytics and a number of other organizations that are gathering data and reporting for us, is there really a role for the CSR report going forward? Or do you think we could move away from that?
I mean, I think we always say, right, that the day that there's no reason for our job is like a good thing, not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, ideally, you know, it would all be integrated into financial reporting and all the other initiatives that you mentioned. But so, yeah, I mean, if that happened and there was no need for us to write these reports and our jobs were integrated into the business and, you know, everybody had sustainability criteria as part of their performance evaluation, I think we'd all be pretty happy that we're in this, that we've gotten to that point. Mm-hmm. I think it's a pretty far, it's conceivable, but I think we're really far away from it.
I think it's a great question. And adding now the human rights reports coming out, Unilever was the first one to follow the UN guidelines. But not every company does all of those things. Often, you know, your CDP data is going to go into your report under the, you know, under the environment, whether it's carbon or if you do the water footprint. So it's certainly in the short term and perhaps in the long term, I think we'll still see a sustainability CR report for the fact that it is one-stop shopping, that it's bringing all of this together because it's to make it easier for your stakeholders to find this information and also for you to be able to tell your story in the way that you want to tell your story instead of having somebody get your CDP report and telling your carbon footprint story themselves. So, you know, it might change over time, but again, I think we're going to see this changing with digital, that there's going to be more access to data. It's going to be maybe real time. I don't see that in the near future, but I think we're going to be seeing more data, more frequent data, ESG data, than just on a yearly basis. And the frequency of that, I think, is going to depend upon, is it valuable to see it more often than once a year? Some of this data, I think you made that point earlier, Lee, is not going to move that much. So once a year is more than enough. But if you also think about using data as a way, you know, that this is performance data, it's not reporting for the sake of reporting. It's managing your ESG performance, the way you manage financial performance. So you internally, at least, you want to be looking at this data and looking at it holistically. I was sharing with somebody before, I had a client and we were doing their report and it was one factory. Their water data was just crazy. It was, you know, hundreds of millions of gallons. And we were having a back and forth with the head of EHS and he's like, no, the data's right. I said, I think there's something wrong here. So either it's the data, which we can help you with, or you have a really big leak that you want to deal with. And it's so, but you know, that's just a, you know, an anecdote, but you really should be looking at your data, you know, to see where are we meeting these targets? You know, are things going according to plan? So I think to that point, you know, you then might be able to release as you, again, it's voluntary, where you think it's appropriate, where you think it can be helpful to share that information with your stakeholders. But there is something to be said for one-stop shopping, I think, at least once a year that you bring it all together.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's increasing integration. We've all said that. I mean, certainly sustainability fits beautifully with brand equity, and you can see the creation of a new brand like Hewlett Packard Enterprise. We have an opportunity to bring those things closer together. I think certainly employee engagement dovetails beautifully into HR. So there's a number of areas of integration, but I think big companies will need a sustainability team and a sustainability report for some time to come, because we put a different lens on things. And it surprises me still how often I talk to my colleagues in the business unit, business units, and I find out, you know, that they're looking at a great innovation or something that they're doing, and they're not looking at it through the lens of sustainability. So having people who are doing that for them, I think, is absolutely critical.
And you can perhaps even thinking about sustainable development goals that I know we're going to talk about later today. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing that I would say, you know, the sustainability team are probably the ones who are starting to report about that. And then at some point that will move into. So it's almost like the innovation department on what is it that's going to be so valuable that it will also sit into the financial report and SEC reports.
Yep.
So more questions.
Hi, my name is William Dyson. I'm from a company called EcoAct. Chris was talking about the challenges in setting targets and objectives. And I was wondering from the panel, just what are the thoughts on science-based targets? And has this helped stir the conversation a little bit more on how to set targets? What are reasonable targets? Has it been difficult to kind of integrate? I know HP is planning to have a science-based target, so it's just kind of interested in kind of the feedback on that.
That's a great question. And actually our operational target that we achieved early because of the wind deal that we made in Texas was a science-based target. So we worked with WWF on their 3% solution, and they helped us to get to that goal, which was to reduce our carbon emissions in operations by 20%. We had set goals against operations previously, so I think that was a second generation goal, but it was in line with the 3% solution. And one of the things that we're doing right now is working closely with WRI. There's a lot of W's out there, aren't there? WRI, and I think it might be BSR, who are looking into science-based targets against scope 3, which is a little bit more challenging.
Yes, I wanted to talk about data quality, because you mentioned your anecdote and you verify your data, and you know that it can be quite challenging when you're dealing with auditors and so on. But I think you're quite an exception. In my experience, lots of companies don't ensure the data or don't make them verify by third party. And is it something that clients ask, or customers, or NGOs, or whoever is reading the report? Is it something that really adds in? I mean, it hasn't had added value, you know, it when you deal with the data, but it is something that people are asking for, or is it going through that direction, do you think?
We did it just to make our jobs a little harder, actually. the reason we did it, it was self-inflicted, because we were looking at what the top companies were doing. And it was, I think at the time, 75% of the Fortune 250 were assuring some of the data in their report. That was insight number one. The second was we did our carbon footprint, our scope 3 footprint for the first time. And we thought, we had a little bit of internal resistance to that, frankly. I mean, we're an engineering-based company, and a lot of people were, how can you report a carbon footprint? Is it really 49 million, 57,000 tons, or whatever it is, right? So, and we were like, no, but that's the best estimate we could make. But in order to kind of get people internally aligned, we said, well, we'll get it assured. And so then we were able to, you know, verify the assumptions, because, you know, any kind of scope 3 carbon footprint has a ton of assumptions in it. So we were able to verify what those assumptions were, and that we were collecting those data accurately. So that was good to get internal agreement. And it also lends some credibility to it when we talk about it.
Yeah.
All of that kind of has created a sort of process that has gotten better and better. You know, the first couple of years were challenging, but assurance now runs pretty smoothly, and the differences are really not material. The other thing we did with carbon, by the way, is we publish a carbon accounting manual, which is available on our website so that people can see what the assumptions were that we made that went into that carbon footprint. So, I mean, all of that kind of, it's a lot of background work that takes place and enables you to get to things like, you know, strong ratings on CDP and DJSI. And so that's also another good motivation for it. But no customer has ever asked us for assured data, at least not that I'm aware of.
Just good accounting.
It's just good accounting. Yeah, absolutely. Right? And we learned a lot about ourselves in the process about, you know, where we needed to plug some gaps and strengthen our data collection.
Yep. I would repeat exactly what Chris said.
And then I would say we have time for one more question, and then I will ask my dear panelists up here to give me like 3 to 5 words about the future of reporting and value creation. Think about that. Last question. No? Nobody want to have last question. They all want to hear your 3 to 5 words that I just asked you to do. I'm not a nice host here. No last question?
We've reported them to death.
Yes.
Such a stimulating conversation.
So I have my 3 words. Less is more. That's it.
Mm-hmm. More better data.
Integrated digital material.
I am impressed. There's a coffee break, and I'm quite sure that you might have more questions to ask these wonderful people. Thank you so much for...